All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to CrossPoint. We are so glad you're with us today. My name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors here. I want to welcome all of our locations that are joining with us today, everybody watching online, certainly all of you here in downtown Nashville. And I'm excited to continue this series today. In Storyline, we're talking about stories, the stories that we're drawn to and the stories that we're trying to live. And over the last 2 weeks, we've talked a lot about movies, but you know, I wanted to talk about books a little bit today. In my life, I tend to go in and kind of waves where I'll read a lot of books and then waves where I don't read much at all. But I read a lot when I was a kid too. And one of my favorite types of books to read was called Choose Your Own Adventure. Just curious, show of hands, how many of you ever read Choose Your Own Adventure books? All right, so a lot. And one person's really excited too. So there we go. Favorite book. This is going to be a good Sunday. So I really like Choose Your Own Adventure books. I found a few this week. Like, you got to check this one out. This is such a good book. This is Zombie Pen Pal. Come on now. Are you not intrigued? Now, what I have to tell you is it takes a lot of skill to connect Zombie Pen Pal to a sermon. And I don't have that skill. This book is weird. And so we're not going to do this book at all. I'm putting it away. Instead, I'm going to turn to this Choose Your Own Adventure book. It's called The Abominable Snowman. This is the first in the series. And a Choose Your Own Adventure book really is. There's multiple storylines in this book that as you read along, you can kind of make choices and go to different pages. And easier to kind of bring you into it than to maybe tell you about it. So we're just going to dive into a story here, and then we're going to make a choice. So after 15 minutes of slow progress, you come across a strange-looking fence. You test it, and a gate swings open. A well-worn path leads to a rock face, and at the base of the rock face, there's a strange carving. A bright red door leads into the rock wall, and a path leads away from the wall. What now? So now we have to choose. We either go through the door, or we follow the path. So what do you guys vote? Are we going through the door, or are we taking the path? Okay, so listen. This happened in the last service too. I just need to let you kind of see behind the curtain for a second. I'm not just making this up as I go. I've already kind of thought where I'm going to go. How in the world do all of you vote the same thing and it's not the thing that I want to go to? So, do you want to go to the door or the path? The path. That's a great choice. Let's go to the path. Thanks so much. Now you're with me here. I didn't really see you going this way. But all right, because the door is too scary. That's what it says right here. Who knows what's behind it? The path, at least, is in the open. Within 50 paces, you are up against a steep rock cliff. You hear the high-pitched call of the Yeti. Who of us has not heard that before? Loud and mocking. And a crackling sound makes you look up. A huge avalanche thunders down at more than 200 miles an hour. Okay, I'm going to hit pause here because I don't really want to get hit by an avalanche today. That's not on my list. And so the good news is I kept my finger where we were before, so we're just going to go back. And we're going to pretend like we didn't make that choice, and instead we can go choose a different storyline. See, that's the key of the Choose Your Own Adventure book. It actually gives you this at the beginning of the book. It kind of explains how these books function. It says, beware and warning. This book is different from other books. You and you alone are in charge of what happens in this story. The wrong decision could end in disaster, even death, but don't despair. At any time, you can go back and make another choice, alter the path of your story, and change its result. Now, don't you just wish life kind of worked that way? Don't you just wish when we found ourselves in a story and it wasn't going the way we thought it was going to go, that you could just go, oh, time out. I didn't really realize this is what was going to happen. I'm just going to back up a little bit. We're going to choose differently again. Don't you wish you could just, as you get into something, go, you know, I'm going to hit the reset button because I don't think I like this story. I don't like where it's going, but it's fine. I'm just going to hit reset. See, that's, I think, why people are drawn to these Choose Your Own Adventure books is because deep down in our own stories, we really don't like conflict. And when I say conflict, I'm not just talking about fighting or arguing. I'm talking about conflict as the idea of the negative turns of the stories that we experience. If you're talking about the ups and the downs of your life, I'm talking about the downs, those moments, that conflict. We resist conflict like crazy, and we do everything to avoid it because we understand that once you're in it, you can't hit reset and you can't start over. That for the most part, when we hit conflict in life, your only choice is to push through and to try and overcome. And that's what we're talking about today. We've been using a definition in this series. A story is a character who wants something and has to overcome conflict to get it. Last week, we talked about this idea of wanting something. What is worth wanting in this life? Because once you've established that, what we all have to embrace is that at some point in our stories, we're going to find ourselves in conflict. And the definition says conflict isn't meant to be avoided, and you can't back out of it. We simply have to overcome. And we've been looking at the story of Joseph in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis. As a matter of fact, we built this storyline of Joseph's life. If you were here on week one, we walked all the way through his entire story, 13 chapters of the book of Genesis, and it's kind of represented here. This is his life, the ups and the downs of his life. And the reality is that Joseph had more than his share of conflict and more than his share of things to overcome. As a matter of fact, it's remarkable that Joseph made it at all. You know, you see it here in his story. He was just 17 years old, thought he was just going to the fields to help his brothers, but they sell him into slavery. They betray him. And it's a pretty big negative turn in his story. And then later, he gets falsely accused, so he gets sent to jail. And then later, just when you think things might be getting better, he has a friend who forgets about him, and as a result, spends an additional 2 years in jail. But what's really remarkable about Joseph's story is that he could experience this level of low in his life, and yet he had a remarkable outlook on life. Because you read the scripture and you look through it, there's no evidence that suggests that he got bitter or that he got angry, that he gave up, that he quit. You know, the Bible says that God was with him through all this. There's no evidence that suggests that at some point Joseph went, you know what, God? I like that you're with me and all, except that you being with me isn't really working out for me. It doesn't seem to be helping things very much. So I think I'll just go on my own if it's all the same with you. Now, Joseph never did this. He had this remarkable outlook, and he overcame in significant ways. And it just sets up the question to me, how does someone overcome that kind of injustice? How do they maintain a great attitude? How do they stay hopeful? How do they persevere? And how do they overcome? And that's what we're going to talk about today. And to do so, I want to talk about another book. It's a book that I read when I was 19 years old. It's called Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl. I was in a particularly philosophical point of my life, 19 years old in college. I'd been trying to figure out the female mind, and I gave up on that and decided to take on something easier, like the meaning of life. And so someone referred me to this book. And this book has stuck with me ever since I read it at 19 years old. It is a powerful book, an unbelievable story. I found myself multiple times in my life where I've quoted this story and certain ideas about it. And I think it speaks to this idea of how do we overcome the conflicts in our lives. But the reality is, I could just tell you what the book says, and it might take 30, 60 seconds. But to be honest, I don't think it would move you, and I don't think it would do much to help you in your situation. That the reality is to understand the significance of how this guy, Viktor Frankl, overcame, you really have to understand the depths of which he had to overcome. And in a perfect world, I would just say, tell you what, everybody, let's make a deal. Go home, read the book this week, come back next week, and we'll talk about it. But that's not really practical or realistic, and then I would have nothing else to say today anyway. So instead, we're going to do something I don't think we've ever done at CrossPoint before. And that is we're going to do our best to try and draw you into this story. We're going to change the environment of the room. We're going to bring some images and all we're trying to do is, in the short time we have today, is to do our very best to help you experience what it would be if you sat and you read this story from cover to cover, and if you walked with Viktor through the struggles of his life. Because once you've done that, the story of how he overcomes becomes very poignant and powerful, so much so that maybe it'll stick with you the way it stuck with me from so many years ago. So if you'll indulge me, I want to tell you a story about an Austrian doctor named Viktor Frankl. He practiced medicine at a clinic in Vienna for 30 years. He studied at Harvard and resided there. He lectured all over the world. He had 29 honorary doctorates, and he wrote 39 books before he died in 1997. But the thing that is perhaps most interesting about Viktor Frankl is the time and the place where a lot of his theories evolved, where his study of psychiatry really took off and really what he's known for. Because the year was 1944, and the place was a concentration camp called Auschwitz. And though I'm going to tell you a lot of his story, I also want to use some of his words. Said, "It is easy for the outsider to get the wrong conception of camp life. A conception mingled with sentiment and pity. Little does he know of the hard fight for existence which raged among the prisoners. This was an unrelenting struggle for daily bread and for life itself, for one's own sake and for that of a good friend." But let me back up and set up a little bit more about who Viktor was and how this story began. He was born in Vienna into a Jewish family. He went to medical school to become a psychiatrist, and he practiced there. As a matter of fact, he worked at a clinic, and his primary role was to treat women with suicidal tendencies. And it said over his time there, he would treat almost 30,000 women, and he would have no idea how important this would be for his life later on. The Nazis invaded Austria in 1938. And when that first happened, not much about his life changed. The first thing that happened is they said you could no longer treat Aryan patients. But other than that, life went on. And Victor fell in love with a girl named Tilly, and they got married. But then at some point, things began to change, and the Jewish people in this particular part of Vienna were all moved out of their homes and into an area of the city that was called a ghetto. And there were fences around it, and this was their new world, contained and not free to go anywhere else. But Victor was able to continue to practice medicine. He could treat people at a small clinic there inside the ghetto. But his life changed forever in October of 1944, because that's when he and his wife Tilly and everyone else in their ghetto were loaded onto trains. They weren't told where they were going, and they weren't told how long it would take. It was 1,500 people that was loaded onto this train, 80 people per car, and they just grabbed whatever possessions they could hold or that they could sit on, and they loaded the trains and they headed out. And after a few days, they finally pulled into a train stop, and they saw a sign that said Auschwitz. And for anyone who had heard that this place even existed, their heart sank. They were boarded off of the trains, and they were separated into two lines, one for the men and one for the women. And that was the last time that Victor ever saw his wife, Tilly. These lines were separated. You were directed to go to either the left or the right. But again, there was no explanation as to the significance of what happens if you go left and what happens if you go right. Victor went to the right. And later that night, he would learn the significance of that selection and that choice. What they were deciding was who could work and who couldn't. And 90% of the people from Victor's trains were sent to the left because they couldn't work. And that 90% of those people didn't survive a single day in Auschwitz. The stripping away of identity happened one step at a time. First, your freedom was taken from you. Next was your possessions, all those things you had traveled with by train, everything that you had with you, all the way down to your wedding rings or any jewelry you had. Next was taken was your clothes and your hair. Victor says this, "While we were waiting on our shower, our nakedness was brought home to us. We really had nothing now but our bare bodies, even minus hair. All we possessed literally was our naked existence." And then the last thing they took was your name, because he was no longer Victor Frankl. He was now prisoner 119104. Victor tells a story of working out in the fields. He said, "We stumbled on in the darkness over big stones and through large puddles, along the one road leading from the camp. The guards kept shouting at us and driving us with the butts of their rifles. Anyone with very sore feet supported himself on his neighbor's arm. Hardly a word was spoken. The icy wind did not encourage talk. Hiding his mouth behind his upturned collar, the man marching next to me whispered suddenly, 'If our wives could see us now. I do hope they are better off in their camps and don't know what is happening to us.' That brought thoughts of my own wife to mind. As we stumbled on for miles, slipping on icy spots, supporting each other time and again, nothing was said, but we both knew. Each of us was thinking of his wife. Occasionally, I looked at the sky where the stars were fading and the pink light of the morning was beginning to spread behind a dark bank of clouds. But my mind clung to my wife's image, imagining it with an uncanny acuteness. I heard her answering me, saw her smile, her frank and encouraging look. Real or not, her look was then more luminous than the sun which was beginning to rise. And a thought transfixed me for the first time in my life, that love is the ultimate and the highest goal to which man can aspire. I understood how a man who has nothing left in this world may still know bliss, be it only for a brief moment, in the contemplation of his beloved. In a position of utter desolation, when man cannot express himself in positive action, when his only achievement may consist in enduring his sufferings the right way, an honorable way, in such a position man can, through contemplation of the image he carries of his beloved, achieve fulfillment. For the first time in my life, I was able to understand the meaning of the words, the angels are lost in perpetual contemplation of an infinite glory." Victor said that a prisoner's best escape from the camp was in his dreams. He said what they dreamt of most was bread and cake, cigarettes and warm baths. He talks about a night when he was awoken by the man sleeping next to him. The man was clearly having a nightmare. And Victor's first instinct was to wake him from it, but then the thought occurred to him that no nightmare, no matter how difficult, could be worse than the reality to which Victor would be awakening him. And so he let him continue to sleep. There are many attempts of suicide by the prisoners, and the camp rules forbid you from interfering and stopping someone from committing suicide. But these men got to know each other, and they cared about each other. And Victor was a psychiatrist. He studied the human mind. And so he wanted to do all he could to prevent people from committing suicide, to prevent them from giving up. But to do so meant you had to anticipate when they were reaching the breaking point, when they were getting to the end. One of the indicators he figured out involved coupons. See, when you worked, you would occasionally be paid in coupons, and you could redeem coupons for cigarettes. And if you were lucky, you could trade cigarettes for extra soup. And so Victor would watch and keep an eye out for men who were actually smoking their cigarettes, because to do so means they no longer viewed it as a currency that could get them more food and could keep them alive, and instead it was just something to help them enjoy their last few hours. And this became a driving force in Victor's life, a daily reason to continue to live. The only way to fight the psychological forces of the camp was to continually look forward to a life that would exist after it's done, to look ahead to a time when there would be a future, someone to return to. They had to continually find for themselves a why to survive. They learned that suffering was not something to avoid, it was something to be conquered, that you had to face up to the full amount of suffering to try and limit yourself from weakness and to limit your tears. And this became Victor's strategy to stay alive. He would search for purpose in every moment of his day, and he would do his best to help other men do the same. In his book, Victor never talks about himself as a hero. He's focused way more on the other people who so often found a capacity for compassion and sacrifice for their fellow man. There were those behaviors that demonstrated that inner freedom cannot be lost, a spiritual freedom that cannot be taken away, that makes life meaningful and purposeful. It brings me to a short paragraph. It's the thing that I most remember from reading this book for the first time back when I was 19 years old. Victor says, "We who lived in concentration camps can remember the men who walked through the huts comforting others, giving away their last piece of bread. They may have been few in number, but they offer sufficient proof that everything can be taken from a man but one thing, the last of the human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any set of circumstances, to choose one's own way." One night, there was a gunfire off in the distance, and it got louder, and it grew closer, and it became very clear that the Allied advance had finally made its way to the camp where Victor was staying. And a battle raged through the night, but the next morning when the sun came up, there was a white flag of surrender hanging at the front of the camp, and the gates were wide open. But Victor and the other prisoners, they really didn't know what to do with it. Because so many times they had dreamt of this moment, the idea of freedom, the ability to walk out, but then they would awake to the reality that it was just a dream. And so even in this moment, it was hard to accept that this was real. Victor eventually walked up to the gate, and he says, "It was so strange to not be met at the gate by shouts of guards or by gunfire, but to instead pass through peacefully." And he didn't really know what to do or where to go, so he just aimlessly walked for a few miles. And then with no idea of what to do next, he walked back to the camp, and he went to sleep in his hut because his mind simply couldn't picture any other outcome. It was a few days later that he was walking out through the countryside, a few days after the liberation of this camp, and he was all alone, walking with nothing to see but earth and sky and open space. And at that moment, he dropped to his knees, and he began to say a sentence over and over. It was a paraphrase of Psalm 118, where he said, "I called to the Lord from my narrow prison, and he answered me in the freedom of space." And Victor's not sure how long he knelt there and how long he repeated that phrase over and over, but he said that was the day that his life began. "I called to the Lord from my narrow prison, and he answered me. And the freedom of space. And it begs the question, how in the world did Viktor Frankl survive a concentration camp? Because that's the reality. It's why we did this. When you dive into his story, when you look into all that he experienced, when you consider the depths of what he went through, and you try and you place yourself even just superficially there for just a moment, it is remarkable that he survived at all. And it begs the question, how did he survive a concentration camp? The reality is it wasn't any one thing. There wasn't one thing that he did that kept him alive. The reality is he made dozens of daily decisions that led to his overcoming. Simple decisions. Like as often as he could, he would shave his face because he understood that that would make him look a little bit younger and potentially a little bit healthier. And if he looked healthier, then maybe he could keep working and maybe he wouldn't be sent to the gas chambers. He made the decision to not go and try and escape with some of his friends. It had been his plan and they'd been working on it for a while, but when the moment came, he chose not to go. And that was a good choice because his friends didn't make it. He made the choice to volunteer to go treat patients who were in an infirmary tent with typhus. And he understood by going and working in that tent, there was a good chance that he was going to get typhus too and that he could die. But he made that choice. But it turns out it worked out for him because from that point on, some of the guards saw him as more of a doctor than a prisoner, and so they'd occasionally give him a little more food, and they treated him a little bit better. When you look at Viktor's story, it's actually astounding that he survived because time after time, small, somewhat insignificant decisions made a huge difference in his ability to survive. And the challenge with that is I can't look at the life of Viktor Frankl and say, okay, great, here's 10 steps on how you can overcome conflict. I can't look to the things that you're experiencing or have experienced and say, no problem, here are 10 easy ways for you to overcome your conflict. I don't think that's real life. I think the things that you navigate in your life are very specific to your situation, and there's a sensitivity that I can't simply tell you how to overcome. The reason I bring Viktor's story into this, and the reason I think it's helpful to where we're going in this series, and why I thought it was important for us to talk about today, is that there was a principle, a guideline that he followed. And I think it sets up how we begin to overcome the conflict that we experience in our life. It's the most famous thing that he's known for. It's the quote that I remember going back all the way to 19 years old, and it's the reason people talk about Viktor Frankl today. How did he survive a concentration camp? He clung to the only freedom that the Nazis could not take away, and that was the freedom to choose how he responded to a given set of circumstances. This is how we wrote it in your program. We don't always get to choose what happens to us, but we do get to choose how we respond. I think that's an important thing to consider. We don't always get to choose what happens to us, but we do get to choose how we respond. And it wasn't just true for Viktor Frankl. It was also true for Joseph and the story that we've been looking at in this series. Because if you go back to the storyline of Joseph's life, these ups and downs that he experienced, he did not choose the circumstance he found himself in. Joseph did not choose to get sold into slavery. He did not choose to be falsely accused and imprisoned. He did not choose to be forgotten by a friend. He didn't choose any of those, but his response is incredible. It is a picture of consistency. He gets sold into slavery, and his response is to be honorable and trustworthy and kind, so much so that Potiphar puts him in charge of his home. Then that doesn't work out for him, though, and he's falsely accused. He's sent to jail, and how does he respond to that? He is faithful to God. He is kind. He is trustworthy. He is competent. He is strong, so much so that the head jailer puts Joseph in charge of the entire jail. Time and time again, Joseph chooses powerfully and consistently how he responds to the things that happen to him. But it's not as simple as to say Joseph kept a good attitude in the midst of it. It's not that Joseph rolled with the punches. It's not that he kept his chin up. It's not any hollow cliche about how we simply will ourselves to overcome. Now, there's this incredible pattern in Joseph's story that when we look at it in Scripture, it shows up time and time again. It's like, look in Genesis. This is when he sold into slavery. The Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. It happened again when he is falsely accused and when he's placed in jail. It says, but while Joseph was there in the prison, the Lord was with him. He showered him with kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. And it happens again. Joseph is removed from jail and he's standing face to face with Pharaoh, the person who has the power to change his future. And this is what happens. Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream and no one can interpret it. But I have heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires. See, it's not just that Joseph chose how to respond to those situations. It's how he chose, that he was absolutely convinced that God was with him. And that sets up a second principle, a second guideline for us that is as important as the first. As we seek to navigate the conflict that we're experiencing in this life, the truth is how we choose to respond reveals what we believe about God. That's true, isn't it? How we choose to respond isn't just how we feel in the moment. At some level, doesn't it speak to what we believe about God? I know it does in my life. You know, I've been taught that I'm supposed to live my life open-handed, that to the best of my ability to understand that God is going to bring things into my life and out of my life, and to the very best I can, I'm going to live a trusting lifestyle. But my tendency when things start to go wrong and when I feel something slipping away is I just clench it as hard as I can with both fists and hold on for dear life. And at some point, doesn't that say something about what I believe about God and whether or not I can trust him with my story? And maybe in your life it's true. Maybe it's true with worry. Worry is really an interesting phenomenon because it is pretty universal. And yet, no one has ever successfully worried their way out of a problem. Worry is the last attempt at control. When nothing else feels in control, it's our mind's attempt to stay in control. And when we are consumed with worry, doesn't that at some level reflect what we believe about God, whether or not we believe he cares about our story, whether or not he's present, whether or not he's really with us? But it's true on the other side of the coin as well. There are very good things that reveal what we believe about God. That there are some of you who have been hurt in incredible ways, and yet you found the capacity to forgive. And doesn't that say something about what you believe about God? And some of you have gone through incredible messes in your life, but you've allowed those to be redeemed. They're no longer your mess, they're now your message, and you use it to help other people. You see someone in the circumstance that you were once in before, and you use that experience to help them. And when you do that, doesn't that say something about what you believe about God and his power to play a part in your story? See, it's true of Joseph. He didn't choose what happened to him, but he did choose how he responded. And what he believed is he was absolutely convinced that God was with him. And that value informed every decision that he made. And it sets up the question that I have for you today. What would be different in your life right now if you were absolutely convinced that God was with you? Would you be a little less afraid? Would you be a little more hopeful? Would you have the strength to fight another round if you were absolutely convinced that God was with you? I believe that you would. I believe that you would. I believe that God is with you. I believe that he is present in these situations and that he's a God of overcoming. There's so many places in Scripture that tell me that, but there's one I want to show you, a place where God makes a promise to Joseph's father, Jacob, and that promise was also for Joseph, and that promise was also for Viktor Frankl, and that promise is also for me, and that promise is also for you. You find it in the book of Isaiah. It says, but you, Israel, are my servant. You're Jacob, my first choice, descendants of my good friend Abraham. I pulled you in from all over the world, called you in from every dark corner of the earth, telling you, you're my servant, serving on my side. I've picked you. I haven't dropped you. Don't panic. I'm with you. There's no need to fear, for I'm your God. I'll give you strength. I'll help you. I'll hold you steady. I'll keep a firm grip on you. I believe that's true. And I believe as we move on into our week and as I try and point you towards hope, what I would say is, I hope you can read that or hear those words and believe that they're true. Believe that promise is for you in the midst of the things that you're navigating and the things that you have to overcome. What would be different for you right now if you were absolutely convinced that God was with you? Because we don't get to choose what happens to us in this life, but we do get to choose how we respond. And how we respond reveals what we believe about God. What an incredible opportunity to try and live out a life of overcoming, an incredible redemption story, and the story that God is writing in humanity. Let me pray, and I'm going to talk more about where we're going to go next week. God, I just pray for those right now who are in the midst of navigating conflict, who in some cases may feel your closeness and your guidance, and some point may feel all alone. And I just pray that they will receive this promise. It's here in Isaiah, but it's all throughout your scripture, God. Over and over, you tell humanity, don't be afraid, I am with you. And I think we need to hear that today as we navigate the conflicts of our life. I pray that you'll be with us, that we will feel your closeness, that we will feel empowered to choose our response, that we will not be victims of this life, but that we will overcome. And that as we overcome, we will use that overcoming to tell better stories and to share hope with someone else. That we will not merely survive this life, but we will move through it and bring people with us. We will speak your truth and your overcoming to all who will listen. And God, I ask you to move in our lives because I am absolutely convinced that you are with us. It's in your name that I pray. Amen.